Hey guys, welcome back to our place for another video. Today I'm going to share with you a couple of dinners that we've pulled together this week using markdowns that we found at the supermarket. So I've got a little grocery haul to share with you first. I'll show you all the bits and pieces that I picked up this week. This is my grocery haul for the week. I am using things that I already have on hand in my fridge, freezer, and pantry, but these were all the goodies that we found marked down, and I'm going to cook up a bunch of dinners with this stuff. I mean, it's one thing to show you guys a grocery haul with all the bits and pieces that we found marked down, but what do you do with it, particularly if it's short dated and you need to cook it quickly? So whenever I find things marked down at the supermarket, you do need to think fairly quickly on your feet about what you're going to do with it, whether or not you can make something in the next couple of days, whether or not you're going to be able to pull some things that you've already got on hand in your fridge, freezer, and pantry together to make a recipe, whether or not you need to pick up a few more things at the supermarket. And mainly I'm also thinking, what am I going to do with this? Are these meals that I can freeze? Can I cook them and they'll last in the fridge for a couple of days? Oh my goodness, there's a lot going on that happens when you see stickers at the supermarket. So before we get too excited and buy stuff, I do like to have a little bit of a plan, but then it gets down to cooking some beautiful dinners and saving a few dollars at the same time. I really enjoy picking up markdown specials. Not only do I save myself a couple of dollars, but I also like using produce that otherwise is just going to end up going in the bin because it's gone bad. Most of the times I find that all of this markdown produce is still pretty good, particularly if you have a plan to use it early. Always check to make sure that things are firm. If they're supposed to be firm, they're not moldy, and they don't have anything weird or strange growing on them or going a little bit soggy. So if you can, a sniff test is always a good idea. Don't be worried about green leafy vegetables that are starting to turn just a little bit yellow. They're still okay, but we do want to look out for mold and soft spots. I always avoid those products, but if I can find things that still feel good, smell good, and look good, maybe they've got a blemish or two, I'm definitely going to pick those up, put them in my basket, and come up with a plan to use them up. So let's get into it. And this is today's little haul. This did cost $60.10. And this is what we grabbed. So I've got a bunch of silver beet here for 99 cents. That's sitting at around $4.50 a bunch at the moment. I've also got a marked down kale for $1. These are also $4.50 normally. This one is a little bit yellow, but there's enough there that's salvageable that's worthwhile grabbing a bunch there. I will need to prep that and get that in the fridge straight away. I've also picked up a couple of little markdown bundles here. This one's a mixed pack for $2.99. Does have an eggplant, a capsicum, and a tomato over the back here. They all feel fairly firm, so that's not a bad deal. I've also got a bunch of mushrooms. I should have actually weighed that to find out how much that weighs, but for $3, that's a pretty good deal. And these little brown mushrooms, they don't sell them in the punnets here, they're just loose, but I think they're normally about $17 a kilo, so that's probably 2 punnets worth. So what's a punnet? 200 grams, so 2 little punnets. I don't know, not a bad price. Anyways, some mixed fruit here. We've got a couple of apples, a kiwi fruit, and a teeny tiny little stone fruit of some description. $3 for that one. Again, everything feels pretty firm, so not a bad little markdown price when you consider the price of apples, which we will get to here at the moment. This here is not a bad price. Capsicums up the back, we've got some green and yellow. Again, fairly firm. This one does have a little bit of a bad spot, but when you're getting them marked down, you've got to expect there'll be a little bit that you'll probably have to cut out. $2.50. Capsicums ranging in price here depending on the color, but about $12 for green, all the way up to $16 a kilo for your red and your yellow. I can't remember which one's more expensive, but yeah, they get pretty exy in exy. Bananas are normally $7 a kilo, and we've grabbed two big punnets here. Again, I haven't weighed them, but there's probably close to 2 kilos worth of bananas. $2.50 for this bunch, and over the back here is $4.50. This is massive. These are pretty ripe, but I like to use bananas for baking, so these will be great for what we want to do. Once we peel them, I'll check. Usually, even though they're still a bit spotty, they're still good to eat for a day or two, and then I will put them in the freezer and we can use them in smoothies, or I can pull them out and use them in baking. Sticking with the fresh produce, I will just pop over here to the apples, and you'll see why I got so excited about picking these apples up for in this punnet for $3 with a kiwi fruit and a little tiny stone fruit. These were $9 a kilo for pink ladies, so the four here cost us about $7.50, and the gala apples are $10 a kilo here at the moment, so these three here cost us $5. So $5 here, or to be exact, $5.44 for these three apples, $3 for this bunch over here, plus, you know, we've got a kiwi fruit and whatever that is, I don't know, nectarine? It doesn't look fuzzy. I'm pretty sure it's a teeny tiny nectarine. Teeny tiny. All right, in other news, I've got a packet of frozen raspberries. They didn't have the mixed fruit, but they've got the raspberries back, so that's exciting. That was $7 for 500 grams. I've also picked up a tomato paste. I'm going to be doing some chili and stuff like that, so I'll need some of that. Peanut butter, not cheap. I think this one here is $6-ish. For the crunchy peanut butter, but it's just peanuts and a little bit of sea salt, so much prefer to get that one than one of the other ones. It's got heaps of extra added stuff in it. We've picked up some more honey because we are just about out of that, and I've got two tins of diced tomatoes and two tins of corn kernels. I didn't have frozen corn, but the truck had only just come in when we got there, so they'll probably have corn tomorrow, but I didn't want to go back just for corn. So that is today's little grocery haul. Let's get started on dinner for tonight. And let's just imagine for a moment that we still have half a wombok left over from the last time that we went to the supermarket. So you would have seen me pick this up in my day in the life, what I eat in a day video. We just had a little grocery haul in it, and then I just showed you a snippet of what I ate like in just one day. But this is what we're doing for dinners pretty much this week with the bits and pieces that we picked up. So we have half a wombok that was marked down when I picked that up the other day, so we need to use it up. So as well as my wombok, I have some spring onions that I also picked up. They'd be a week old now. They definitely need using. They've been in the fridge for a little while. The good thing is onions and stuff like that tend to last for a bit, but yeah, these are definitely on their last legs. I think they are at least a week old. And the mushrooms that I picked up today. So I saw a recipe online, have no idea how I came across it, but I found it anyways, and it was a wombok and black fungus soup. Now, I don't have any black fungus, but I thought mushrooms would be a pretty good substitute in that. So we're going to give that a go. For the saucy part of this evening, I have the last of my crushed ginger, which I'm going to use up. Always very excited when I use the last of things. Some sesame oil, which again, I think I'll probably end up using the last of that. That has been hanging around for a very long time. We will throw in a little bit of soy sauce. The original recipe called for oyster sauce. I don't have that. And rice wine, which I also don't have. So we're going a little bit off book. I'm going to throw in some lemon juice. We do need some chicken stock. Don't have chicken stock, but I do have just a straight up vegetable stock, so that'll do. We'll use that. Need to make a bit of a, well, I need to thicken the sauce up, so good old corn flour. And I think that hopefully there's enough in there. Oh, that'll be the last of the corn flour as well. Gosh, don't you just love it when a recipe uses up like five things? It's amazing. And this wasn't in the original recipe, but I think the idea of throwing in some sweet corn sounds delish. So we'll do that as well. And then the original recipe said to serve it on rice. So we've got rice. That's the plan. Anyways, let's see how it comes together. I'm going to start by cleaning about half of the mushrooms that I picked up in today's grocery haul. I am going to reserve the other half for another recipe. For today's soup, I'm going to thinly slice all of our mushrooms. We just really like thinly sliced fried mushrooms, but you could do chunky mushrooms if that's how you like your mushrooms. And I'm going to dice up our wombok. Yes, I did give it a quick wash first. I am separating out the green leaves from the white stalky ends because our green leafy end doesn't need to cook for as long. The white end does need to cook a little bit longer in the soup, so I am actually going to cook them separately. And of course, we're going to dice up our onions. And again, I'm going to separate the white ends of the onion, which I'm going to cook earlier on. They need to cook for a little bit longer. And I'm going to reserve the green leafy ends of our spring onions to use as a garnish. With all of my prep work ready and done, I'm going to get on to my rice. I am actually cooking up 3 cups of rice today. I only need a little bit for our soup today, but I am going to get a head start on another recipe that I know I'm going to be cooking in a couple of days' time. So I'm going to prep that rice now. I like to cook my rice via the absorption method. So I use 1 cup of rice to 1.5 cups of water. And I always like to rinse my rice so that it's nice and clean. Because I am cooking it via the absorption method, that means that anything that is in the pot is going to be on the rice when we go to eat it. Back to our soup that we're cooking off today. I'm going to start by frying off the mushrooms. Now, I'm not actually going to keep the mushrooms in the broth when I make it. That is because Charlotte is not a fan of mushrooms. So I'm going to use that as a topper for Shannon and I, but you could absolutely leave those in the pan. There's no need to take them out. I'm going to braise that white part of the wombok. I do want to cook it off a little bit, but I really want it to stay nice and crunchy. So again, I don't want that to cook for too long in the broth itself, but I do want it just to be nice and tender and crunchy. The broth I'm going to make with 2 teaspoons of ginger. Now, I probably put a little bit more in for this recipe, but that's fine. I was just using up everything that was in that jar and frying that off with my onions. If you wanted to just use regular onion, that would work fine as well. Again, I'm using up the spring onions that were in the fridge. This is a great use it up, clean out the fridge recipe. For the broth itself, the soup, it's a stock-based broth. So I'm just using vegetable stock and water. I think that this soup could have actually had more liquid in it, but I was limited by the amount of stock powder that I actually had. So I only had 2 teaspoons, so I could only add 2 cups of
water, but I think it would have been nicer actually if it was 3 cups of stock, and I will make a note of that for next time that I make it. It definitely needed to have a little bit more liquid in it. Also went ahead and added in 3 tablespoons of soy sauce, and that's pretty much it for the soup. Once all of that comes together, we can start adding back in our vegetables. Don't forget to add in the corn starch slurry, which is what I did. That thickens up the soup. So it's not quite brothy, but it's also not a thick, creamy soup as well. But it does just thicken that up a little bit. Back to our veggies. I've got the white part of the wombok in. I'm adding in the corn. I'm going to let that just cook for a couple of minutes before I add in the white part of the wombok. This doesn't need very long at all. It just needs a minute or two just to wilt in the pan. Any longer than that and it really starts to get quite soggy. So to keep this fresh, we just really want to have the vegetables in that hot broth just for a couple of minutes. Basically, once that's all combined, I'm going to go ahead and add the tops of the spring onion as well. And that's it. That's the end of the soup. This was so quick and easy to pull together. If you've only got 15 or 20 minutes for dinner, this is a fantastic recipe. It was really quick and easy. It doesn't take a lot of actual cooking time, and everybody really enjoyed it. Now, I always like to go and test before I serve, just in case anything needs a little bit of extra salt or pepper or any extra flavorings. But this one was simple, lovely. It was filling, but it wasn't a heavy, hearty meal. We did serve it with a little bit of rice, which is what the original recipe recommended. But I actually think that the wombok and mushroom soup stands alone as it is if you just wanted more of a soupy dinner. But this was absolutely fantastic, and like I said, we topped ours off with the mushroom, and this one got 10 out of 10 for us.
Dinner tonight is again going to be a bit of a taking a recipe that I've used before and then just completely changing it so that it's something completely different. So I've done an Italian rice and white bean wampan dinner, which is delicious. But I don't have any white beans, so I'm going to throw in some lentils that need using up, and I'm going to cook them at the same time as the rice. So I'm actually going to use brown rice. Normally I use white rice. I'm going to use brown rice and the lentils. They'll cook at the same time, so that'll work. And I'll throw in some quinoa as well. Now, as far as veggies go, I will throw in some onion and garlic. I have some onion here that needs to be used up because it's been cut up. I'm going to use up the other half of our mushrooms, and I'm going to use the kale that I bought marked down. It is a little bit yellow, but it's still okay. I did discard a few bits of looking just a little bit grotty, but we've got enough here for one meal, and so I'm going to use it up in here. We're also going to throw in some diced tomatoes and a little bit of extra tomato paste, and of course Italian herbs and stock. It's going to be a lovely one pan dinner, so let's get this happening.
For this recipe, I'm going to start by dicing half an onion. You could actually add a little bit more onion to this one if you wanted to, but I was trying to make my onions work across the week and I only had 2. And I'm going to dice up a couple of fresh cloves of garlic as well. Again, you could use crushed garlic if that's what you've got. I've been using a lot more fresh garlic and really enjoying it, but it is a little bit more prep work. And I really wish I actually had a garlic press because I think it would make things a lot easier. But go ahead and get our onions and our garlic ready, and we're going to thinly slice our mushrooms as well, just like I did the other day. Again, this is personal preference, just because we prefer to have our mushrooms thinly sliced and really well fried off. I did cut these a little bit smaller so that I could hide them in tonight's one pan dinner, so that Charlotte wasn't as aware of the fact that there was a whole heap of mushrooms in there. And because this is loaded with so many other vegetables and grains and things like that, it was easy to sneak them in there. I rinsed up 1 cup of brown rice, 1 cup of our lentils, and 1 cup of quinoa. This dish is going to require quite a bit of liquid to cook all of our grains and our lentils. So I started with 3 cups of water, but I did check that, actually, a correction, 4 cups of water, but I did actually check that and add more water as this continued to cook. I'm also adding in a tablespoon of our Italian herbs and a tablespoon of vegetable stock powder so that it has a bit of extra flavor. I put the lid on this one, brought it to a boil, and then turned it down to a low simmer and let it cook for 10 minutes before I started to check. So each time I'm checking, I'm just giving it a little bit of a stir and checking to see if it needs any extra liquid. After 10 minutes, I went ahead and added in our tin of diced tomatoes and another cup of liquid, as well as 2 tablespoons of tomato paste, making sure that this is all well combined and making sure that nothing is actually sticking to the bottom of the pan and that all of our grains and those pulses are actually cooking through properly. After another 10 minutes, which I didn't show terribly well there, I added in an additional cup of water and I threw in our kale on top. Now, I had prepped this earlier, so I de-stemmed it and chopped it up, and I'm basically just leaving it on top so that it can steam before I mixed it through with the rest of the ingredients. So our rice and lentils require 30 to 40 minutes of cooking, so it is going to be on the hot plate for a while, but it's also very hands-off and very easy because it's a one pan dinner. It came together beautifully. This was so delicious and made a boatload.
Tonight I'm going to use up our capsicums in a 3-bean chili. So I did cook some pinto beans this week. If you guys have been watching for a while, I've been trying to rotate through different types of dried beans. So I'll cook 1 or 2 different types of dried beans every week, but I'll have some things in the freezer. So I've got pinto beans that I just cooked, but I've also got red kidney beans and some black beans in the freezer. So I'll be using those up. Again, throwing in those capsicums that I picked up marked down. And to round out the rest of the chili, I'm going to throw in some corn plus some tomatoes. So I've got diced tomatoes and I'll also throw in some tomato paste, onion and garlic, of course, and then seasonings. So I will add a little bit of stock powder, but most of the flavorings is just going to come from taco spice blend. You could do all of the individual spices if you want to, but I'm just going to use the taco seasoning. And the magic ingredient in every good chili is a little bit of cocoa powder. Don't knock it until you've tried it. Cinnamon sometimes works really well as well, but this is what's going to go into our 3-bean chili tonight, and I'm going to do a really, really big batch so that I can get some of this cooked up. We can have leftovers and I'll get some in the freezer for later on down the track.
All right, for this one, we're going to start by prepping our capsicums. And if you guys have not seen this method of cutting capsicums, then you absolutely have to give it a go. It will change your capsicum game for the better. By cutting your capsicums this way, you actually keep the seeds all contained together, so you don't have capsicum seeds going everywhere and creating a big mess that you have to clean up. It is the easiest way to cut up a capsicum. I went ahead and diced up all 3 of my capsicums. The two green capsicums were actually quite small and had a couple of blemishes that I needed to chop out. So it ended up being a 1-to-1 ratio as far as the colors go, but it really doesn't matter. You can throw in whatever you've got. You can actually use whatever vegetables you've got. I tend to throw all sorts of different vegetables in my chilies and I think it still works. Dicing up half an onion. Again, I am saving the other half for another recipe because I am trying to stretch the two onions that I had across four different meals. And I'm going to go and dice up four garlic cloves as well. And that is pretty much all of the prep work that I need to do for this chili. I really like chilies because they're such an easy, versatile recipe. Not only can you throw a bunch of different ingredients in it, but you can cook it in a pan, you can cook it in a slow cooker, you can cook it in a pressure cooker. The longer that you can let your chili simmer for, the better the flavors are going to be. So you're going to want to start off by browning off your onion and garlic. I like to give those a minute or two head start before I add in the capsicum. And you really want to let those cook on a nice high heat so they can get a nice bit of charring to them. After a minute or two, go ahead and add in your can of crushed tomatoes or diced tomatoes and a can of water, which ends up being about 400 mils of water. Don't forget to swirl your water around and get every last drop of tomato out. You don't want to waste anything at all. And I'm going to add in 2 tablespoons of taco seasoning. I am taking a shortcut here. If you wanted to build up your chili flavors with your own herbs and spices, you are welcome to go ahead and do that. I'm also throwing in 1 tablespoon of vegetable stock powder and 2 dollops of tomato paste. They're probably tablespoon-ish, but it is not an exact science here in my house when I'm cooking. Do not forget our secret ingredient, 1 teaspoon of cocoa powder. Don't mock it until you try it. It just rounds out your chili and adds this amazing flavor. It doesn't taste chocolatey. It just tastes amazing. I also went and added in 1 cup of each of our beans. If you're only doing one type of bean, just go ahead and add in 3 cups or about 2 tins. I also added in 1 tin of corn, and that is pretty much everything that's going to go into tonight's chili. This is all about cooking time. So like I said before, the longer that you can let this cook for, the deeper those flavors are going to be as they develop. I like to turn this down to a low simmer and just forget about it for at least half an hour. If I have more time, I actually prefer to cook this in a slow cooker because I think you get better flavors. Now, remember that white rice that I prepped earlier? Well, we're going to use it tonight with our chili. So I did take a bit of a shortcut the other day and I prepped some rice because I knew that I was going to make this chili with the capsicums. I'd sort of had a bit of a hankering for chili and here it is. This was absolutely delicious. You can top this with whatever you want. If you've got cheese, if you've got avo, you do you, but this was beautiful.
Tonight we are going to use up our little pack here with our eggplant, capsicum and a tomato in it, and we're going to do a scrappy curry. So this is all about the sauce, which we'll get to at the moment. I've done a whole bunch of different varieties of this. I used to do a scrappy fish curry. This is a scrappy veggie curry. It's awesome. You can basically throw in whatever you want. This is a great way to use up leftover bits and pieces in the fridge. So we're going to throw in our silver beet, the last of the carrots, eggplant, capsicum, tomato. Of course, you're going to need some onion and some garlic, but this is all about the sauce. So for our sauce, we're going to need 1 tin of tomatoes. Yes, I know I've got a tomato there, but it's not quite enough. 1 can of coconut cream, some curry powder, turmeric, and garam masala, and that is it. It is so easy. As long as you've got these things here on hand, your coconut cream, tinned tomato, curry powder, turmeric. I mean, yeah, you could probably even leave out the garam masala if you wanted to. This is your sauce. Everything else is just whatever you can throw in. And we're going to serve it on some brown basmati rice, because I feel like we've done white rice and brown rice this week. So let's do some basmati rice and do something a little bit different. If you were feeling up to it, you could make some naan. That would be great, but we're just going to pull this together and we're going to have a lovely scrappy curry for dinner.
All right, well, as per usual, we are going to start by prepping our onion and our garlic. You guys have seen this a million times before, so I'm not going to show you too much of this, but we are going to dice up an onion, and we're going to have some garlic going as well, because onion and garlic, they just go together. I'm just using up the last of what I've got. You could probably actually have a little bit more onion and garlic in this recipe, and I think that it would actually bring out the flavors a little bit better, but beggars can't be choosers, and this is what we had left, so this is what went in it. I'm also going to go ahead and prep the rest of my veggies. Now, this recipe is super versatile when it comes to vegetables. You can put a bunch of different veggies in this and it seems to turn out great every single time. Like I said to you before, this is all about the sauce. What you put in it can change. So I have done this with fish and chicken. I've actually done it with prawns as well. That worked quite well. If you are eating vegan or plant-based, then this goes with just about every vegetable that you can imagine. I have used this sauce in a bunch of different curries. It's so quick and easy, and I always have these seasonings on hand so I can always pull it together. I like to use this basically same method with sweet potato and lentils and white potato, and you get the gist. All right, so once I diced up all of my veggies into bite-sized pieces, I went ahead and also just quickly chopped up my silver beet. I like to de-stem it. That's just a personal choice. You can leave the white stems in if you want to. They are edible. That's just a personal preference at our place. And I'm going to dice up the tomatoes. Now, I did separate out my harder vegetables that are going to take a little bit longer, and I'm keeping the silver beet and the fresh tomato separate because they won't need to cook for as long. So I've got my eggplant, my carrot, and my capsicum all diced up, ready to go. And I've got my silver beet and my tomato. They're going to go in the end. Once again, I've got some rice cooking using the absorption method. And again, I did actually cook extra, so I have some in the fridge, or it can go in the freezer for later on down the track. I really like to cook once and eat twice, so if I can prep ingredients as well, I will do that. We're going to start off by frying off our onion and garlic, and then we're going to get our spices on top of that, and we're going to cook those spices off on a dry heat to bring out those fragrant spices, the taste. You want to have a dry heat, particularly with your Indian spices. I think that makes all the difference. So you like to crack them over a little bit of heat first. Once they're fragrant, that's when you know you can start building up the rest of your curry sauce. So I went ahead and added a little bit of water. I'm going to go and just bring those spices off the bottom of the pan before we add in our tin of tomatoes, which I also added in a tin of water. So again, another 400 mils of water to our curry sauce. Now, this curry sauce ended up being very runny because the coconut cream that I purchased actually was more like a coconut milk. So it wasn't thick and creamy. It was a little bit runny, but it was still really nice and all of the flavors were there. I like to cook off the harder vegetables for a good 10 to 20 minutes, depending on the vegetables, before I add in the coconut cream and the softer vegetables. So today, our eggplants and our carrots had 20 minutes before I added in the coconut cream, which as you can see is super runny. It's more like a coconut milk, which was a little bit disappointing in that I thought that it was going to be a nice thick creamy curry, but it was still super delicious. The flavors were all there, but it was just a little bit runnier. Now, if I hadn't used all of my corn flour the other day, I could have used a bit of corn flour to thicken it up, but I didn't have any left because it was a use it up week. It's okay. It is what it is. It was just a runnier curry, but it was still delicious. I popped in our silver beet and our fresh tomatoes for the last 5 to 10 minutes of cooking. I don't like to overcook silver beet. I really just sort of like to heat it through. And then it's pretty much ready to go. Our rice was finished, so it was time to dish it up. So again, as you can see, this is super runny. This is almost like a soup rather than a curry, a thick curry. But the flavors were there. It was delicious. I think it was the coconut cream, but anyways, it is what it is. It was still a lovely dinner and we really enjoyed it, but that's real life. Sometimes recipes just don't go quite the way you expect them to, but we still had dinner on the table and it was still delicious, so that's all that matters in the end.
Well, there you go. That is everything that we cooked up this week at our place, using up all of the markdown specials that we found this week at the supermarket. I'm going to head back to the supermarket and let's hope we can find some more markdown goodies, because I always think this is a lot of fun. It actually helps me to get really creative. Sometimes I have to think outside the box. Sometimes I have to Google some new recipes, but that is the brilliant thing about having the internet in your pocket everywhere you go. Be in the supermarket and just chuck in, what can I do with two random ingredients, and see what the internet gods have for us. Anyways, I hope you enjoyed today's video. I had a lot of fun coming up with these recipes. We had a lot of fun eating them. They were all really, really good. If you enjoyed today's video, I'd really appreciate it if you could give it a thumbs up. That lets me know the kind of content you guys are enjoying and what you'd like to see more of. And as always, if you would like to see more from me and you haven't already, now would be a really good time to go and hit that little subscribe button down below. It is the easiest way to be notified when my new videos come out. Well, I hope you are having an absolutely fantastic week, and I do hope to catch up with you in my next video. Until then, take care, my friends, and we'll chat soon. Bye.